All right. It is Monday at 4 o'clock, that time we come together to do our update on COVID-19 here in the Commonwealth, the challenge of our times. You know what? I'll start the way that we used to always start because we all need to hear it, especially as it looks like we're going to go into a very difficult fall with this virus. So we're going to get through this, and we're going to get through this together. We're going to talk later about how that's going to need us to react and respond with urgency to make sure we're doing our part, and mainly to make sure we are wearing our masks. We're not seeing enough of it at the moment. I can plead, I can beg, but I can also tell you that for a fact, the amount of our economy that's open, the ability to get our kids back in school, and the number of lives we lose or do not lose depend on a number of things, but primarily the number of people willing to wear these masks. So today, I'm wearing the Barberville Tigers. That's Barberville Independent. Thank you to their frisky director, Samantha Daniels, for sending it. Appreciate them trying to keep their kids safe. All right, our fast for today, those things we start with to make sure you see a number of different things going on in the state, starts with what we did yesterday, dedicating a Gold Star Families monument here at the Capitol. The final Sunday of September is set aside as National Gold Star Family Day, a day to venerate the many brave U.S. military members who made the ultimate sacrifice in defense of our nation, and to recognize that every one of those individuals we lose was a part of a family, and that those family members also carry the trauma of losing a loved one, and that they sacrifice too. So yesterday, the Gold Star Families Memorial Monument was unveiled on the grounds of this state capitol before dozens of families. The memorial helps us honor Gold Star families. The registry of Gold Star families includes nearly 10,000 Kentuckians that are a part of that fellowship. These are our sons and daughters, our brothers and sisters, our husbands and wives that answered the call and then didn't return home. They fought for all of our freedoms, and the gold stars bestowed with an honor those families that no one seeks, but makes them a part of a special fraternity. Yesterday, we celebrated the lives of those Kentuckians. We lifted up their families, and now we have something on these Capitol grounds that show a little bit about our values, and that we valued each and every one of these individuals. I invite Kentuckians to come and to see this memorial. It'll add another part of Kentucky history, but also part of who we are at our core right here on the Capitol grounds. All right, next, we are now in the midst of this election coming up in November. Early voting in person hasn't started yet, but absentee voting is underway. This is my absentee ballot. It means that they are being mailed out. It means you have the opportunity to fill them out, and you need to make sure you do it appropriately. There are instructions that come inside of each absentee ballot about not only filling out the ballot, but what you have to do with the internal envelope, signing it, sealing it. What you have to do with the external envelope, signing it, sealing it. Make sure you follow those instructions. You then have two different things that you can do with this absentee ballot. You can mail it, and if you're going to do that, mail it soon. I'm mailing this today. I will have voted. Or you can drop it in a drop box, which the First Lady's going to do, and we're going to show people what that looks like. So remember, you can register to vote until October 5th. You have until October 9th to request one of these, an absentee ballot. After that, early in-person voting begins on October 13th, and we want everyone that's gonna vote early in person really to do so before Election Day because you can spread out and stay safe. But there is no excuse, folks. Voting is a part of who we are as Americans. It is your duty, if you have the ability to vote, to do so. And now you have more opportunities and less excuses than ever before. I want to see a record turnout. Regardless of how the elections go, I want a record turnout here in Kentucky. And I think that we can and we should do that. All right, a little bit of good news, and that's today's jobs announcement, and we're going to have one at least the next 3 days. It shows that we are continuing to make sure that we are attracting the types of jobs here in Kentucky that we truly need to compete in this next 10, 20, even 30 years. So today, I'd like to congratulate Summit Biosciences for receiving final approval earlier this year from the Kentucky Economic Development Finance Authority. Summit is a homegrown Kentucky company that was founded in Lexington in 2009 and is located at the UK Coldstream Research Campus. The company is investing more than $19 million new dollars and will create 78 full-time jobs with this project. The expansion is near completion and will support clinical and commercial production of several new nasal spray medicines, including one for COVID-19. In May, Summit was awarded a contract from Seattle-based pharmaceutical company Atossa Therapeutics to accelerate the development of a nasal spray medicine to prevent and/or to mitigate a COVID-19 infection. Summit was selected for the contract based on its specialized capabilities, established infrastructure, and proven track record in the development of nasal spray medicines. This product will be an at-home, easy-to-administer treatment option. Summit's grown significantly in recent years, with 45 employees in 2016, growing those to 125 currently. So congratulations to everyone at Summit Biosciences, including President COO Greg Puchinski, for the great work the company is doing overall and in the fight against COVID-19. Just another company doing their part. You think right now it's Kentucky companies that have propelled us to where we are, from testing to even looking at those next steps we can do to protect our people. And finally, Mask Up KY. We'll be announcing the details, I believe, tomorrow, but we are going to be starting up a Mask Up KY contest here in Kentucky. The idea is that we need more positive examples out there of people wearing their masks. So starting next week, it will move from simply us wanting you to fill up social media to us presenting three winners each day that'll receive a free Team Kentucky mask that they can wear for being such good members of Team Kentucky. So we're asking everybody to make sure, whether it's Facebook or Twitter or any of the other parts of social media, Instagram, get out those positive messages. Here are a couple of folks that did so for this week. The first is Regina Hudson, and this is the Threads of Hope PPE delivered on a promise to myself, my wife Brittany, Mask Up Kentucky, and Covering for Kids. It's 530 reusable masks to Silver Creek Elementary for students, teachers, and staff. Also sent 100 to the Berea Food Bank. I want to thank them for their work in making sure that we are safe in this return to school, and for those who are ensuring that everybody is fed during this pandemic. The next is Mrs. Duvall getting ready for the start of school, and this would be today. She says 9 hours and 2 bottles of disinfectant later, she thinks her classroom is COVID ready. We wish her the best. We thank her for being patient and knowing how critical this return to school is. We're going to talk in a little bit about where we are. I believe we're at least the start of another escalation of COVID cases in this country and in this Commonwealth. And it's going to be more important than ever that we do this right. And if you want to make sure that her classroom is safe, you got to make sure your community is safe. Because the individual who brings COVID into a classroom got it somewhere else. And so if our kids are going to be wearing masks in a classroom, we need you to do so in your community. Set that good example. Remember, it might be uncomfortable, and we might not want to spread out like we need to with social distancing. We might not want to follow all those rules. We might not want to cut down on our numbers of contacts, but our kids in that classroom are counting on you. The likelihood that they can continue is based on what we do every day in our communities. Surely, we can sacrifice for those kids. Okay, and finally, this one we were going to do last week but couldn't fit in. Again, this is an attempt for our kiddos to get back to many of the things that they do. I've been to a number of these classes pre-COVID when my daughter was doing ballet, and we appreciate them trying to do it and do it right. All right, next up we have Secretary Eric Friedlander. He's going to talk about pandemic EBT, which is our commitment to making sure that our children and all Kentuckians are fed, have their basic needs met during this COVID crisis.
Couple of quick updates. First, I want to begin with the hard work of the folks who have worked at the Cabinet for Health and Family Services to get people eligible and through our systems to be eligible for services. As of today, more than 1.6 million people have enrolled in Medicaid. This is about a little more than one in three Kentuckians, and we have added over 250,000 people to receive Medicaid. This is important. If we're in, and we are in, a pandemic, it is vitally important for individuals to have health care coverage so that we can pay doctors and nurses and hospitals and make sure that the folks who are providing health care can get paid for the services they're providing. Next, we have provided over 100,000 households access to food through the SNAP benefits. This is an important piece to keep people fed during a pandemic. Many people have lost their jobs, and this is a way that we can provide those services. Folks who have lost their jobs, we have outreach to many of those folks to see if they need SNAP benefits, to see if they need Medicaid benefits. We are actually the only state in the country that I know of that have proactively reached out to those folks who have had to get unemployment benefits. Lastly, we know within the next week or so, since the beginning of the pandemic, we have provided or will be on the verge of providing over 2 million meals, 2 million additional meals to seniors across this Commonwealth. And we would not be able to do this without our partners. So the next piece that I want to talk about is the pandemic EBT piece. We talked earlier about pandemic EBT. It goes to individuals and children and families who otherwise would be receiving meals in schools, but because schools have not been in session, they haven't been able to access those meals. To date, we had a first phase, and we provided those benefits to over 500,000 children across Kentucky. Our partners in Department of Education helped us do that. We took applications, and we have now just entered the second phase of that pandemic EBT service provision. What we've done is we've again worked with our partners in the Department of Education. They have provided us with information about folks who are eligible for free and reduced meals throughout the educational system. As of this weekend, we sent the files in order for individuals to receive these benefits as well for August and September. That is over 625,000 children who are going to receive these services and receive meals and receive food. This time you don't require an application. We will be sending these benefits to you. There'll be new cards that arrive sometime between in the month of October is what we're aiming for. The mails have slowed us down a little bit, but we expect that individuals will receive those cards in October. If you have questions, we have provided our staff with the information they would need to respond to your questions, and you can call 855-306-8959. That's 855-306-8959. 8959 and select the food benefits option, and you will get information about the cards that will come to you in your mail. You'll need your birth date and some other information to activate the cards, but when you receive them, know that those services will be provided. It's related to the number of days that you're in school or school is in session, and so that is different for each school, but we have the information to provide the right amount of benefits on those cards. So to date, over 500,000 in the first round, over 600,000 in the second. We've signed up we've delivered benefits to about another 1.4, 1.5 million benefits to individuals in Kentucky during a pandemic. Having food, having health care is very important for the individuals. It is also very important for our communities. So thank you to the Department of Education. Thank you for the workers in the Cabinet for Health and Family Services. If you're calling those lines and you're calling those numbers, thank you for reaching out to us. Avoid Mondays. Again, thank you. Thank you, Governor, for this opportunity.
Thank you so much, Secretary Friedlander, and I can attest to the hard work that the folks at the CHFS have done and in the education cabinet as well to make sure that our kids are fed in the worst of times. And so without your leadership, that wouldn't be possible. So thank you. So today I'm here to talk about the new school reporting link that has gone live. Today is September 28th, so it is the first day that the governor recommended in-person classes resume. And so today we knew that the reporting link for schools would go live. And so our schools are asked to self-report Monday through Friday for each day that their school is in session. And the reason this information is so critical is because it's about our communities. First and foremost, our parents and caregivers, they deserve to know this information. They deserve to know how the COVID pandemic is impacting not just the greater community, but specifically the school building that they send their children to every day. It also is very imperative for our teachers and our school staff to know how this COVID pandemic is affecting the children and other adults that they interact with every day. And so I'm going to show you an example of a dashboard and what it looks like today. It is populated by the school's self-reporting, as you can see on the screen. The dashboard is updated daily. Anything that is reported over the weekend will be included in the Monday reports. The data will be one reporting day behind. Dr. Stack explained that earlier, that reports are due by a certain time in the day, and it will be updated by the following day. So it will reflect the data from the previous day. And you can always find the date of that specific report at the top of the table. So for example, if you look today, Monday, September 28th, the last reporting day was Friday, September 25th. And so at the top of that table, you will see as of September 25th, 2020, and that will be the indicator for what those numbers are. If a school has not reported, that will also be noted on the dashboard. If you look at the left side of the screen, you can see in that chart that you can filter at the state level, at the county level, at the school district level, and down to the actual school building level. So you can look at any kind of a filter for your community or greater region in your area. If you have questions about your school's self-reported numbers, then you need to contact your local school or the school district itself. And if you do not see your school listed, we ask that you reach out to alert that school, but also to let us know by emailing chfslistens@ky.gov. And I will close today by saying that this is the first day that this is live. Our schools are getting used to this new reporting system, as we will get used to reading this data, making sense of this data every day. And so I'm going to say what I always say: please extend grace to our school leaders, to our teachers, to parents that are trying to navigate these waters that are very unfamiliar for all of us. Thank you so much.
Lieutenant Governor, I think we've got your or the Secretary's folder. All right, want to thank Secretary Friedlander. I think the steps that we have been able to take during this pandemic to help people have been so necessary. And in most instances, I think that this state has done a very good job. Does that mean in others that we couldn't have done better and that we can't do better in the future? It doesn't, and we should. These are the times where we have to be there for each other. And I know our mission as a part of the state is to try to be there for each and every Kentuckian that needs us. All right, today's, if I'd call it a word for the day, what I hope really sinks in to everybody watching is the word urgency. I believe that since maybe the traditional start of school, we have become more casual in our approach to COVID and our concerns about COVID and in how well we follow those rules and guidelines that are out there. It can be natural. It's been 7 months, and most of us have never had to deal with something like this for 7 months. It's probably also psychological in that we have seen specific days and times that maybe our rhythms run on each year, the traditional start of summer, the traditional start of school, where we see, you know, kind of changes in behavior, maybe wanting so badly to go back to pre-COVID norms that maybe we at least try to pretend like it doesn't exist. But the virus is here and it waits for us to get casual. I believe it's a lack of urgency and some poor decision making that led to what we saw in Florida, which I think just passed 700,000 cases. It's what we saw in Texas, where there wasn't room in some morgues for what they were dealing with, in Arizona, in South Carolina, and in many other places. And when we get casual, when we don't show urgency, what we see is alarming trends in the virus, more cases, and ultimately more people passing away. So we are going to make it through this, but when we get to the other side, do you want to look back and think we could have done better when doing better is about saving people's lives? Do we want to get to the end of this virus and say, I'm just not really happy with the fact that I got a little exhausted in it and maybe didn't wear my mask as much? I lost my friend Alice Sparks at the end of last week. Lived in Northern Kentucky, lived a wonderful life, lived life to its fullest. But Alice should still be with us. I can name a half dozen other people that I knew that well that aren't with us anymore. Remember, when we are casual, we do not show urgency. The results are somebody that you might not know passing away, but other people know them. And what we are seeing right now requires, I think, even more urgency. Can you show the graph of the United States and what we are seeing in cases? So as you all know, in the beginning of this, in March, what we saw was a rapid increase in cases. New York had its hospitals overrun. We saw how that can almost exponentially increase the number of people that we lose. We did something that I think has been done very few times in history. We took some really even severe steps. In being healthy at home here in Kentucky. And we were able to blunt that curve both as a Commonwealth and as a nation, though some suffered more. But then we saw what happened when we got into the summer. Again, I think some folks were just, you know, wanting to get back to that normal summer. You would hear, how could you steal summer from kids? And what do you mean the pools can't be open? And what we saw was a rapid escalation in this country where certainly the cases overall increased even more than what we saw in March. We saw mask mandates pop up at this point all around the country, steps that needed to be taken. people rightfully being very worried starting about July 5th, and we saw another decrease. But when you look at that graph, we never got down to the levels pre-July before we saw it coming. And now, what we believe that we are seeing, and I believe we're seeing it nationally, is the start of a new escalation of that line not going down, but going up. And these are total cases that we are seeing in the country. And as we come towards a fall season and winter, where more people are going to be inside, where we know the virus spreads faster, we got to do better than this. We can't be casual right now, and what we do right now may impact us 2 weeks or a month from now. Let's look at the Kentucky cases, because what we're seeing nationally, we're seeing here too. Last week, we had almost 5,000 cases, the most that we have ever had. Folks, we've been at this long enough to know what we can do to reduce the number of cases. We've done it several times, yet we're having the largest number of cases right now. We've got to have urgency. We've all got to believe that 4,949 cases are far, far too many. And I now believe that we are not sitting at a plateau, but we are seeing what would be the third escalation that we've dealt with here in the Commonwealth. We have to do better. We have to act with that urgency. We look at the White House report, which came out today. We had been pleased in the weeks before to not be in any of their red categories. We're back in one. We're in the red category for increasing overall number of cases. Thankfully, we're in the yellow category in our positivity rates because we're doing a lot of testing. But being in a red zone in a time of COVID means our people will suffer. And I had somebody talk, I think that it was an individual told this to our inspector general. He said, well, I hear you all, but I just go to the mall and I don't see people with COVID. COVID is one of these invisible killers that when you have it, you're quarantined at home or you're in the hospital, that you're not seen out in your community. But everybody knows at least one person now and sees one person they know whose family is suffering and says, if you all will do one thing, please believe this is real. Let's listen to them. Let's make sure that we are treating it like it's real. The White House report this week lists now red, orange, and yellow zone counties. That's what we do in our incident report. Here's the red zone: Warren, Laurel, Union, Callaway, Knott, Grayson, Marshall, Estill, Clay, Jackson, Meade, Montgomery, Wayne, and Leslie. A lot of these overlap with our incident maps. Now, we've had, you know, some groups, and I'm not suggesting it's those up here, try to argue their way out of our red status, saying, oh, that's just individuals in a nursing home. When it's there, it's out in the community. Certainly, if you're red in ours and you're red in the White House's, let's admit there's a challenge in the community and that it's time to do more, not to do less. The orange counties, a number of other ones, of course, Jefferson now in this orange zone when it had been in red for a while. Franklin County, too. Frankfort Independent, operating under the zones we put out, is doing small pods starting today because they're in the orange zone. It's the right thing to do for the health of the students and of the faculty. But you can see the number and the breadth of the state of these orange zone counties. COVID doesn't care if you're urban or rural, doesn't care if you're in northern, eastern, western, south central Kentucky. It can very quickly explode in your community. And here's yellow. And listen, we want to be green, but very few counties are green right now. And the yellow counties that they see, again, many of these are kind of riding that wave that we saw Florida ride, that you have a whole lot of cases, and because you've had some, you start to taper off. But then what we have seen in numerous occasions, including Louisiana, which was hit early and then was hit just as hard again, is if we let our guard down for 1 minute, what can happen. I want to give a quick update on the travel advisory states. Remember, we just set a travel advisory for states that have a 15% or higher positivity rate. I mean, I believe 10% or higher is dangerous. We try to stay below 6%. But South Dakota right now, with over a quarter of everyone being tested, testing positive. Wisconsin, close to 1 in 5. Idaho, just over 1 in 5. Kansas, 15. Iowa, 16. It shows you again how this is spreading throughout the country. We also have to make sure that we're carefully watching different areas where the virus can spread. It's an estimation, but it comes from our EPIs. We believe right now we have 44 and a half high school sports teams under quarantine as of today. We have 538 high schools. That is a pretty significant number. It does mean that those schools are doing the right thing, and the local health departments are doing the right thing. But it's something that we have to watch very carefully. And with those escalating cases, with the challenge that we are seeing right there in sports, with our kids going back to school in many places today or in some version, we need urgency from everybody. We don't get to choose the times we live in, but we do get to choose what we do to respond to the challenges we face. This thing is real, so I'd ask everybody, are you going to be proud of the way that you have gone about everything that's needed? I believe the answer for the vast majority of Kentuckians is yes, because I think the vast majority of Kentuckians have done a great job. You've shown compassion and kindness, and I couldn't be prouder of you. This is one where we need everybody. One big team, Team Kentucky. Everybody's got to pull their weight. So let's encourage each other. Let's try to show compassion to each other. But let's step up and show the urgency we need so we don't have another escalation, so it doesn't impact our economy, our kids, and their education. And it doesn't take more lives of Kentuckians. Because as of today's report, we've now lost 1,162 Kentuckians. That's 5 additional deaths today. I think that's too many. I think it's too many. And I think where we are right now is maybe into the place where we're getting into avoidable deaths. So let's make sure we are doing what we have to do to protect the people around us. Total new cases today, 456. That's actually the same number exactly as of yesterday, though there were 8 duplicates yesterday. So our total number of cases since March the 6th, 66,939. Positivity rate, we are still under 5%, though at 4.41%. And we ought to be concerned. We ought to try to push that down. We ought to push that below 4, and we ought to continue to work towards that. 5 individuals that passed away that are included on today's list include a 56-year-old woman from Fayette County, a 91-year-old woman from Jefferson County, an 84-year-old woman from Johnson County, a 93-year-old man from Jefferson, and a 97-year-old man from Jefferson. Let's remember, those green lights are important. Ringing the bells are important. Calling and checking on each other is important. Let's call and check on the families that have lost someone. Let's also call and check on those households where we worry about the kids during this virus. Let's call and check on the households where we're worried about maybe the relationships of the people who live there, and maybe we're even worried about the safety of someone inside it. Let's make sure that we are what we call active bystanders, meaning when we see something wrong, we do something. Because now, especially in the time of COVID, if we don't, it might not be noticed or acted upon as quickly. Now, let's make sure we are doing even more for each other. And when we see something that concerns us, that we pick up the phone and make a call, knowing right now that might be the only chance to stop something wrong that's happening. In future press conferences, I'm going to show the numbers of whether it's the domestic violence hotline, our child abuse hotlines, and others, because I know most of the people out there want to do everything they can to protect people through COVID, and that is one additional thing you can do. Also support those institutions. Our shelters are out there, they are open, they are working to make sure they are COVID compliant. They're having to do new and additional things like hotel rooms to make sure that they can socially distance folks. So now more than ever, let's support them. Our child advocacy centers. New cases by county, Fayette 108, Jefferson 100, Warren 25, Davis and Madison 13, McCracken 12, Boone 11, Allen 10, and the others will be up on our website. Specific areas that we provide updates on, long-term care facilities. This is since last Thursday, 119 new residents, 12 new staff. We've identified 20 additional individuals that have passed away as being associated with a long-term care facility. We'll be talking in the near future about new rapid testing, how that is being deployed in these facilities, and our overall plan for using some of that testing. K through 12 schools. This again is based on the information that lags behind the dashboard that we just created. Again, we'll have two areas that you can look. One is the short term before it's audited, before it necessarily goes through public health, and one is post those audits and reviews. So this is the more accurate number, but doesn't give you that day-to-day or week-to-week picture. 53 new students testing positive, 38 new staff, 37 new schools, and that's just since Friday. Colleges and universities, again, this is just since Friday, 13 new students, one new faculty or staff, and now a few less schools with a case associated with it. Kentucky child care facilities. Since the last time we updated, which was last Wednesday, 15 new facilities, 12 new staff, 7 new children. All right, so we're going to open it up to questions, but urgency. Let's make sure that that word means something to us, and let's make sure we act with it. It's not enough just to have a mask in your pocket, though I appreciate that you have one, and just about everybody does right now. But when we get close to people, let's make sure that we wear it, and let's also make sure we're not trying to find a way around the rules. The rules are there for a very specific purpose. Let's make sure we're following them. All right, we'll start over here today. Joe, you wanna kick us off?
I guess the discussion about K through 12 schools. Obviously today is the day that, at least the statewide recommendation, you said, you know, you can start in-person classes, but you know, obviously we have the dashboard starting to go online here, but as we're talking about the number of cases, you know, an escalation again, more urgency, do you feel confidently that schools across the Commonwealth are ready to handle in-person classes with that?
The question is, with escalation, with what we're seeing in cases, maybe with some of the casual nature we're seeing in our communities and some communities about dealing with COVID, am I confident about our schools and being ready for some version of in-person classes? If they follow the state guidance, if they look at that incident map, then yes. But we have a number of school districts whose counties are red and who are continuing with whatever their former plan was. These are some of the same districts that asked for this metric. If you hit red and you are continuing with in-person classes, then no. I don't have confidence because you're not following the guidance out there. And if the approach is we're going to do what we want to do no matter what, then we can't manage the virus in that way. But for all the other school districts that are looking at it and that are willing to be flexible. In other words, if we are green, we're going to get in as much as we can. If we are yellow, we're going to be careful about it. If we're orange, we're going to do the pod system. And if we're red, we're going to NTI and we're going to get ourselves back down to yellow. We're going to get back in. As long as you're willing to be that flexible, then yes, I think we can do this. And I think we can do it as safely as we can. Safely is a relative term right now. But let's remember, if we have all the scientists and all the public health experts telling you something's not safe right now, then we shouldn't be doing it. And the intent on the state tool is to provide that not only to the districts, but also to the parents. And the dashboard now ought to be giving parents and teachers a lot of instant information. Tom?
I've been hearing over the weekend from state employees concerned, especially at the Department of Transportation Real ID driver's license offices, that there are a rash of positive cases, but the co-workers are not being told of these infections and are not being helped by the health department, and also that there is no plexiglass between the workers and the general public, where there is, you know, many other places, including, you know, room 102 down the hall.
So the question is the reporter hearing about some concerns in transportation and whether or not there have been some positive cases in the area where real IDs may be given, and whether other employees are being told. If other employees are not being told, if we're not being sufficiently transparent with our own employees, it's absolutely unacceptable. I have not heard of those concerns, but when we get done today, I'm going to go do something about it. Plexiglass barriers are a good idea. If we don't have them there, we should. Sometimes the best I can do is respond when I learn about something, but we're certainly going to take a look at it just as soon as I'm done here. Joe?
Do you think that the level of security and law enforcement in Louisville over the past 5 days was overkill for the actual number of protests and demonstrations there?
The question is on the level of law enforcement and other security the last several days in Louisville. Was it too much? Was it too little? First, I'll say as of today, neither KSP nor the National Guard are in Louisville. It's very difficult to know ahead of time exact scale. Let me say this. 99.99% of people that took to the streets or the sidewalks did so peacefully, raised their voices to be heard, and we should listen. We should listen to the trauma and to the pain. Sadly, we had a couple of individuals that tried to take advantage of those peaceful groups, sometimes hide within them, cause property damage, and we had shootings of two police officers that thankfully are both going to be okay. Violence is never a solution to violence. I believe that we can always look back and evaluate. It's hard to Monday morning quarterback. My goal, and all I can tell you is my goal and the decisions we made, and I was very much involved in the decisions we made and even numbers that we sent, was just to keep everybody safe, but also because there were requests made for significantly more that we said no to, also to try to keep it on the right scale or the best scale that we could do with the information that we had. We're also dealing with a lot of misinformation. People using social media that formerly was used for, if you look at protests here at the Capitol, to insinuate that significantly larger crowds were coming and coming from different places. The credibility of those are very difficult to determine, but there was certainly misinformation, maybe even intentional misinformation that was out there.
He said that he was really disturbed by Florida easing the restrictions completely. Given the state of the virus in Kentucky, talking about the escalation, would you consider another two-week suspension of bars, or at least imposing a
So the question is, Dr. Fauci today talked about Florida and the fact that they're going 100% restaurant, 100% bars, let's fill up all the stadiums, let's just pretend like this thing doesn't exist, and like we don't have 700,000 cases, and like it didn't devastate the case just, what, about two months ago. So what Florida's doing is reckless, and it's dumb. It's the best word I can give for it. Every public health expert would tell you shouldn't do it. They just experienced it. They had huge numbers of deaths, huge numbers of cases. And they're going to do this? I can tell you, as long as I'm governor, we're not pretending like this virus doesn't exist until we have a vaccine and until we can deploy it. We are going to continue with our current levels on bars and on restaurants. And if anybody out there thinks that we should just fully open them up to 100% capacity and fill up an internal arena, you got the wrong governor. I'm going to do what it takes to protect people. And just because there might be states around us making dumb decisions, we're not going to here in Kentucky. We care about each other way, way too much. And I'm in the end, politically, I'm not trying to please anybody. I'm just trying to do the right thing.
The September is close to being the month with the most cases. It's already the deadliest month of COVID-19, with 229. And you're calling for Kentuckians to be more urgent. But do you think that Kentuckians might look at you and say, why aren't you a little bit more urgent by issuing new recommendations for schools, sporting events, bars, restaurants,
The question is, am I showing urgency by not imposing new regulations or making changes? You know, the difficult job with making some of these decisions is how protected we are, and I've said this before, is a pretty simple equation. It is the level and effectiveness of the rules times how many people follow them. And you can have great sets of rules and regulations, and if nobody follows them, it's not effective. Likewise, if you don't have good enough rules, even if a bunch of people are following what you have out there, it's not effective. Right now, we're not seeing enough people follow what's already there. And so that takes shifting a little bit. Our goal and our belief is that if we can get people wearing masks, if we can get them social distancing, if we can get them following the very basics, we can start decreasing our number of cases. You know, but we need everybody. They talk about 80% of people wearing masks. We need 100% of people wearing masks. And if we do, we wouldn't have an increase in cases. We wouldn't have another deadliest month. So we know more now about this virus than we ever have before. We just got to do what it takes. And again, I don't want to suggest that most Kentuckians aren't doing it right. Most Kentuckians are doing it right. But we need more Kentuckians doing it right.
People look at September and they see a month with the most cases, are likely going to be the most cases, mm-hmm. and the most deaths. Are you surprised that some people do question the mask mandate? And you obviously you believe it's working.
On the mask mandate, it's every single public health official, every single scientist that says that masks are effective, sometimes even very highly effective, in preventing you from getting the virus and from getting you to spread the virus. We have seen when there is urgency. Look at when other states that were, Texas were skyrocketing and put in their mask mandate, and you can bet people put them on with what was happening. You saw a significant decrease. We know they work, but we got to wear them.
Going back to the school reporting system, when the Lieutenant Governor was talking about it, she said that it will also show that schools don't report cases or numbers that day. Is there going to be any sort of penalty for schools that do not report on a daily basis or routine basis?
When the Lieutenant Governor talked about a day lag where you might not see some cases, it's because they fill it out at the end of days and not at the beginning. Schools will fill out that for every case they know about. A parent that has a child that tests positive has a legal duty to advise the school. That's in statute. It was in statute before we were here. So at least if all parents know that and call the school, then everything will be put up that day that the parent knows about. Now, there may be some instances where the health department learns about it before the school and it comes back. And so we've got to know that schools are doing the very best they can with the information when they have it. And at this point, I'm not concerned that schools won't report everything they know. That's both because I believe our principals are out there trying to do the right thing, but we've also set up a system of redundancies where we have that later report that we show that goes through all the tests that come through the local health department, and they learn. So we have a check on the back end too. I believe that this is a good system. It is really transparent in how it gives people information. Tom?
Updating their testing strategy this afternoon. kept putting off the press release on it, but have you gotten any information yet on what it's going to be and how it may affect Kentucky?
Question is on an announcement about to be made by the White House. I don't want to take their announcement from them. It's going to involve them providing some additional means that we can use to test, and we can talk about what we're going to do with those tomorrow after they've made their announcement. I do want to point out, though, that not only is an announcement on more testing coming out, but the White House in its most recent recommendations to us is asking us to test more people. So any lingering doubts about the CDC suggesting that asymptomatic people shouldn't be tested is gone. I mean, the White House's specific recommendation to us and the actions they're taking is we need to test and test more. Joe?
On State Representative Attica Scott being arrested Thursday night in Louisville and being charged with a felony rioting charge. I believe she still has what charges.
So the question is on State Representative Attica Scott, who was arrested during protests, charged with at least, I think, one felony. It is, I think everybody was shocked to even hear about it. She is a fierce advocate for her district. It is hard to believe. I have not seen any of the information about it, but I hope people take a very careful look. She is a very important part and voice in our legislature, and I don't know any of the specifics, but I would hope that whoever is handling that takes a very close look. I got a couple of written questions. Two schools in one area that are in the red on the metrics map, and both are currently conducting in-person learning. Listen, when you hit red, you need to move to virtual because it means your community has so much spread that it is going through your schools. You're putting teachers at risk. You're putting administrators at risk. It is not a state law that makes you do the right thing, but you should be willing to do the right thing because all the data out there shows that it's not responsible when you are in the red to be having those in-person classes. At some point, we got to have people doing the right thing and showing the leadership to do the right thing. And it can't be give us a tool, and once we get the tool, if it doesn't do what we want, then we're going to ignore the tool. I mean, come on, folks, do the right thing. If you are in the red, it's virtual learning. Hopefully in a week, you can get those numbers down. But it's going to be really hard to get those numbers down if you don't do it. That's why it was put together. Let's see. There's a couple of questions here about, I think they are specific parts of Brianna's law about body cameras, about penalties, about drug testing, if weapons are fired on the job. I think we're having some really productive conversations on parts of that bill. I want to make sure that I do hear from everybody that is interested. We had another productive conversation with community leaders today. I believe that there is certainly the opportunity for significant improvement in our processes and in how we go about doing things like the service of a warrant. And I believe that we are getting buy-in that could lead to very positive change. All right. I want to thank everybody. We've gone just about the full hour. Urgency. This is your Commonwealth. This is your country. How we do against this virus depends on your urgency and those around you. Let's just do the right thing. Let's protect one another. We're going to get through it, and we're going to get through it together. But how well we get through it will depend on your urgency and all of our actions. Thank y'all.